This is the day the Lord has made. We rejoice and we are glad in it. I want to just kind of share from my heart because I know that a lot of us are excited that it appears that we have turned the corner as it relates to this pandemic called COVID-19 that has literally paralyzed the world, but not just the world. On top of that, it has precluded us from gathering as a fellowship, as a family. And we miss each other. God knows I miss you. Nothing fun about preaching to a camera when I can enjoy the wonderful fellowship of being with my amazing family of faith here at Friendship West. And so, of course, now President Biden has mentioned July 4th, there's a possibility that in limited ways we can gather together. I just want to suggest that my responsibility, I feel called of God as a shepherd to remember that I have the calling to both feed the sheep and protect the sheep. And that means I've got to make decisions sometimes that don't feel good. I always want to do my best by the church. I want to answer to God in a way where I'm always responsible. And so given that, I just want you to know that we as a leadership team at the church, myself, I will be doing everything in my power to watch the signs, to listen to the science, and to hear from Almighty God as to when it is safe for us to gather. That's so important, that it's safe for us to gather and to gather freely without mask, without having to deal with protocols and parameters to worship God freely, because the bottom line is when we see each other, oh my God, it's going to be a wonderful experience. And I want to make sure that it's wonderful. I don't want us to be a super spreader in the name of Jesus. And so with that being the case, I wanted to get this message to you to let you know that when it's safe, I promise you, we will get back together. We will reopen, but we're going to reopen responsibly. Until then, please continue to pray for our wisdom. Please stay safe yourself. Until then, please gather with us in our virtual experiences of worship, Bible study, and ministry. Until then, remember the words of that old school hymn, "Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love. The fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above." I praise God for the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love that even COVID cannot break. I look forward to seeing you as soon as possible, or should I say, as soon as it is responsible and safe for us to gather together. Until then, know I pray for you. I love you, and I praise God for you. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us, Friendship West family and friends, for this time of worship. And as we celebrate our senior pastor, Frederick Douglass Haynes III, for 38 years of pastoral service, amen. We thank God for his yes, and we thank God for his obedience on this morning, amen. So we ask that you would send some words of encouragement in the chat room. If you haven't been united with us yet, we welcome you to unite with us here at Friendship West. Please follow the prompts on the screen or go to friendshipwest.org and go to our website, and we would love to have you as our members on this morning. So let's go to God in prayer as we prepare for worship. Father, in the name of Jesus, just how we thank you and praise you for your living word on this morning. We thank you that your word is alive and active in our lives, Lord God. Father, we thank you that the words that you have spoken over your children this morning, on today, Lord God, will be activated in their lives, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray that your word would do surgery on us this morning and search us and free us and heal us and deliver us, Lord God. We thank you for the preached word from the man of God on this morning. May there be power. May it set captives free, Lord God. May your children come home and be saved, Father, because we know that we can't live by bread alone, but it is by your word, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. So we thank you that we are going to follow every word that has come out of your mouth, God, in the name of Jesus. We're going to lean and depend and trust on you, Lord God, in every area of our life. So we pray that you would have your way in this place. Holy Spirit, you reign on the King of glory, Shabbat, Lord God, because we need you during this time and during this hour, Lord God. Be with us in our lives, in our homes, Lord God, and on our jobs, and even in our churches, Lord God. And our word to you on this morning is thank you, Lord God. We exalt you and we praise your holy name, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, because no one compares to you, Lord God. So have your way in this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just when you think hope is gone, the Lord is faithful, oh, so faithful. Bow before him and adore him. And because of his goodness, he deserves the highest praise. Just think of his
these few moments, I want to talk about the champ is here. This ain't entertainment. This is for my people on the slave ship. These songs are just the spirituals I swam against the waves with and made it to shore, much to their amazement. Those are the words of Nipsey Hussle as Nipsey reminds all of us of our heritage in this country of swimming against the waves. We've always known what it meant to swim upstream, but not just upstream, but to swim against the waves. Well, if you didn't get Nipsey, let me see if Langston Hughes can grab you, because with ungrammatical profundity, he embodies the wisdom of a black mother whose son is evidently toe up from the flow up and ready to give up and listen to what this mother says. Again, her language is not right, but her theme and her brilliance is tight as she says, well, son, I tell you, life for me ain't been no crystal stair. It's had tacks in it, splinters, boards torn up, places with no carpet on the floor, bare, but all the while, I's been a climbing on and reaching landings and turning corners and sometimes going in the dark where there ain't been no light. So boy, don't you quit now. Don't you sit down on these steps because you find it's kind of hard. I's still climbing, I's still going, and life for me ain't been no crystal stair. Well, you have yet to get it, but the thematic thread that is woven through the fabric of both Nipsey and Langston, speaking mother to son, is the fact that life is filled with overwhelming obstacles, not just obstacles, but structures and systems that are diabolically designed to preclude the fulfilling of our possibilities. Look again at the staircase. It ain't no crystal stair. It has tacks in it, splinters, and boards torn up. Poetically and metaphorically, Langston is speaking, don't miss this, of the structure that is diabolically designed to preclude the upward mobility of my young brother who is trying to reach the top. There are structures, even today, in these disunited states of America that are diabolically designed to preclude the possibilities of our young people, especially our young African-American males. We are so glad to have a champion in our pastor, the Reverend Dr. Frederick Douglass Haynes III, to help break down the structures and pick us up when we are down with his messages. We thank and praise God that the champ is here.
Wow. Mark Anthony Clauzel, thank you so much. That was wonderful. Thank you so much. Please give it up for Mark Anthony for blessing us. That blessed my heart in a great way. I want to stay obedient to our production today. This is blowing me away. So I want to quickly introduce someone who I have come to know in recent days. As many of you know, earlier this year it was announced that there was going to be a school that would be named in my honor that would be housed at Paul Quinn College. Paul Quinn College, of course, occupies the campus where Bishop College used to be. Of course, Bishop College means much to me, and all that I am or ever hope to be, I owe it all to the grace of God expressed through many individuals and entities, especially Bishop College. And so now there's going to be on the campus of Bishop College a global preparatory academy named Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III Global Preparatory Academy. And that's mind-blowing. I want to thank Trustee Maxie Johnson for pushing that through and for the DISD trustees for making it happen. I've been privileged to meet the visionary who is giving leadership to the Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III Global Preparatory Academy. Trips me out to say that, Dominique. Dr. Frederick D. Haynes Global Preparatory Academy, a school named after me. That's a trip. But anyway, this outstanding young man, Dr. Christopher J. Barksdale, is the first principal. He is the founding principal. He is the progenitor. He is an educator par excellence. He is a gift. He's absolutely brilliant with a wonderful vision. And he's here today just to let you know that we want your students to come to this school that will literally transform trajectories. I present to you now Dr. Christopher J. Barksdale.
Church family, thank you for welcoming me into the sanctuary to greet you on today. Again, my name is Dr. Christopher Barksdale. I am the proud founding principal at Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III Global Preparatory Academy. I don't know about you, but our school name alone ought to make someone want to lift their hands and just tell God thank you. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I am rejoicing not only for today, but for what's in store at Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III Global Preparatory Academy. If ever there was a time to create a more peaceful world, it's now. This new partnership with Dallas ISD and an HBCU institute is the first of its kind in our district. This partnership will create a pipeline to possibilities for our own children by recognizing and igniting the excellence that already exists within each of them. Also, we will equip students with the tools needed to become internationally minded leaders. At Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III Global Preparatory Academy, we believe that education is the great equalizer. Therefore, we will offer rigorous instruction and access to high-quality community support from middle school through college and beyond. Our great school will open in the fall of 2021, and we are currently enrolling students in grades 6 through 7 for the 2021-2022 school year. This school will offer the greatest student experience the world has ever seen. I am here today to make an appeal to parents and students. You don't want to miss out on the great things that we will accomplish as we continue the great legacy of Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III. We have only about 100 seats remaining, and so I encourage families to enroll today. Please visit our campus website via the Dallas ISD district website for more information on how to enroll and to stay in contact with us. Again, it is with great honor to serve as the founding principal to lead this work. Friendship West Church family, thank you again for welcoming me here today. And to Dr. Haynes, happy 38th pastoral anniversary. To God be the glory for the great things that he has done, he is doing, and he will do in our lives. Thank you, and may God bless you and keep you is my prayer.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. As you see, we have a dynamic visionary leader as the principal, and so I'm excited about what's going to take place in the years to come there at the Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III Global Preparatory Academy. Speaking of education, we have, as far as I'm concerned, the Queen of Homiletics as our guest preacher for today. I'm talking about Dr. Teresa Fry Brown. Dr. Teresa Fry Brown is the Bandy Professor of Preaching at Candler School of Theology there at Emory University. Not only that, but she is, without question, one of the great preachers walking the planet today. She's one of my favorite people and one of my favorite preachers. I'm always challenged, edified, healed, set free, stretched every time I hear this phenomenal gift to the body of Christ. And so I cannot wait for all of us to be blessed. Listen, here's what I recommend that you do. All of you who are tuned in right now, go ahead, alert everyone you know to tune in, however they will, friendshipwest.org, Facebook Live, YouTube channel. They need to tune in right now because we are about to be blessed by, again, a womanist scholar, preaching phenom, my sister in faith, who I love, admire, and adore, the incredibly gifted Dr. Teresa Fry Brown. I need you to get ready right now, because it's about to go down like four flat tires, and the devil in hell knows she can preach the paint off the walls and the horns off a billy goat. So get ready to be blessed by this preaching phenom. After the ministry of music, Dr. Teresa Fry Brown.
I really love the Lord. I really love the Lord. You don't know what he's done for me. He gave me the victory. That's why I love him. I love him. I really love the Lord. For they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I will lift up mine eyes to the hills, for it cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord who made heaven and earth. I have been young and am now much, much older, but I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor God's seed begging for bread. For when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he keeps on doing for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. I thank the Lord. I thank the Lord. I thank the Lord for saving me. Thanking God for this opportunity to my brother, my Langston Hughes, the Reverend Dr. Frederick Douglass Haynes III, to my sister and soror, Deborah Peaks Haynes, to Sister Abney Jewel Haynes, to Sister Lynette Haynes Oliver, to the ministerial staff, to my niece, Reverend Dr. Dominique Robinson, the officers and members of Friendship West. It's good to be back. Anniversaries, according to Toni Morrison, are a time of re-memory. A time to reconstruct past realities, to reminisce, to reproduce, to retell about someone's experiences, about someone that's lived long enough to know how God works in many different situations, someone who has watched God make a way out of no way, someone who has faith that is then tried in the fire and lived to tell about it. So in recognition of 38 years of anniversaries of pastors and people, pastor and people here at Friendship West, two passages of scripture compel our attention. The first, Psalm 124. If it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side when our enemies attacked us, then they would have swallowed us up alive. When their anger was kindled against us, then the flood would have swept us away. The torrent would have gone over us, then over us, and over us the raging waters. But blessed be the Lord, who has given us not as prey to their teeth, who has escaped. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare was broken. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. And one verse from my heart text, Romans 8. What then shall we say about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? I'd like to share with you just for a moment on an if-then celebration. The late Dr. Samuel DeWitt Proctor and Dr. Gardner Taylor collaborated on a book in 1996 called We Have This Ministry, the heart of the pastor's vocation. They delineated a job spec that called for the minister, the pastor, to have deep integrity and knowledge of the scripture, intercession and teaching and counseling and administrating and preaching, invested in the lived experiences of the people. They recognized that despite this, from time to time, difficulties come up. Although many people believe that pastors only work on Sundays, they had limitless budgets and support systems are always in place. They may have over 100 ministries, but there are never any questions or objections in business meetings. They never have to react to media. They always are accessible and accountable. They never go on vacations. There's nothing ever happens in worship service. They don't have to prepare for sermons because, after all, you have anointing, so all you have to do is open up your mouth and everything comes out all together. That music is always in harmony. There are never any attitudes. The people give. You never have to appeal for an offering. That, you know, the preacher takes all the money from the church anyway, you know, there's guilt-free time. They're always with their family. The officers never challenge anything. Everybody loves the pastor. The vacations are never interrupted, and they get time off Monday through Saturday. However, the glaring reality is that according to Pulpit and Pew Research, the average Protestant pastor works 35 to 63 hours a week, not the 1 or 2 hours people assume. By estimation, 1,200 to 1,700 persons walk away from ministry every month, and you've had yours for 38 years. They sleep less than 7 hours a night. They're always answering texts and Google Voice and voicemail and email and snail mail. They just left one hospital and have to go to a funeral home. They stopped by the jail because somebody's daughter is in jail again. They called a meeting before the meeting before the meeting because somebody was ticked off about Bible study. Pandemic program adjustments without realizing that it takes 10 times the effort to worship online than it does in person. Missing members who waft negativity like new perfume. The choir has their own idea about what praise and worship is because they watched something on YouTube last night. You know the sermon needs more work, but you just don't have the time. You missed your own doctor's appointments. You're putting out church fires and faith quakes and fights and foolishness mid-flight. People are too busy to attend a meeting, but will complain about the meeting. And the beat goes on. Pastoral ministry is not for cowards, lazy people, power-hungry people, or those who care more about their image than their work. Pastoral ministry requires deep faith work, going not knowing, complete trust in somebody you cannot see, following the orders that only you and God understand, total submission of self that your family thinks you're crazy sometime because you heard a word for God and it wasn't for them. God's divine protection has been with this pastor and the people at the Wild Wild West for 38 years. Since April 10th, 1983, the same year as the first mobile phones, although the pastor loves his phone, the same year as Hurricane Alicia, the same year the United States invaded Grenada, the same year that Martin Luther King Day was signed by Ronald Reagan, that Jesse Jackson announced he was running for president, that Michael Jackson's Thriller was the video that aired for the first time. 38 years. Dr. Haynes has lived and breathed and modeled and preached and written and taught and sung and rapped and danced and if then faith through ebbs and flows and ins and outs and comings and goings and sickness and health and births and deaths. The God-ordained ministry warrants an if then celebration. So as I prepared to preach for today, I noticed the similarities between Dr. Frederick Douglass Haynes III and the Apostle Paul. In preparation for ministry. In our New Testament text, we find a portion of Paul's letter written to the whom it may concern in Rome. Paul was born a Jew in Tarsus, educated at Gamaliel Seminary as Saul, persecuted the people on the way, knocked off his elitist horse in Damascus, convicted of ministry by the Spirit of God, and studied the Damascus Road and street called Straight Seminary with Dean Ananias. He did graduate work with Priscilla and Aquila in tent-making school in Rome. He devoted to establishing his citizenship in heaven, and he wrote to the people, the believers, the Jews and Gentiles in the known world, and those that were able to tell them they could be saved in spite of their current circumstances. There wasn't a church in Rome at the time. He may have had to move to five locations before he got to the one he needed, but Paul was given the task of taking the good news to the whole world regardless of cost. In chapter 8 of the letter of Romans, we find that Rome was a political capital in Western world, and at a similar time, there were same kind of situations. A faithful people seemed unable to do anything about the political corruption and rumors of war. Pandemic disease was taking a toll, and medication was reserved only for well-connected people. Sanctified selfishness, where people were refusing to protect others from their own disease. Spiraling poverty, with people selling their bodies for pennies to pay for rent and food, feeding their children. Loss of homes, businesses closing, pressures to do what the government said, even though you knew it wasn't right. Selective justice in the land. Rich were in control of all the resources. The wickedness was even in the temple, killing what they did not create. Thinking they had time of their lives while others were suffering, drunk with power, following all kinds of God, more time critiquing other people's loving relationships and voyeuristically looking at them instead of their own deteriorating relationships. Strange fruit was still being reproduced as black and brown men and women, names recited daily, t-shirted, hashtag protests, and still being abused, executed, incarcerated, demoted due to the amount of melanin in their pigmentation, their laughter, clothing, music, ability to speak, their attempt to breathe, their sleep, their making their living, protecting themselves, protest inhumane treatment, making a living, evidence that they needed some mental health care, verbally responding, watching birds, standing in line, buying snacks, reading a book, drinking coffee, exhibiting any kind of intelligence, knowledge of a law, and had the nerve to help build the country that didn't want them there in the first place. Waking up and going to bed with negative images. Nightmares all around, but Paul was expected to speak faith into a people who were weary, worn, and sometimes defeated. In the text, we find that the Romans love power. We know that nobody in the United States loves power. But he begins to give details about what to do in this complicity. And Paul hadn't walked with Jesus, but believed anyway. So in my sanctified imagination, I see Pastor Paul sitting at his desk. an itinerant preacher pastor preparing to share a word from the Lord. He was a believer, an author, a rhetorician, an activist, a teacher, a student proclaimer of the word. And he didn't need to Google how to maintain faith in the midst of trouble. He didn't share other people's Facebook posts about what faith was. He didn't scroll through Twitter to see if faith was trending. He ignored all the Instagram stories because they were going to go away anyway. He didn't go to YouTube to see what was streaming about what faith claims were. There was no message left on Google Duo concerning faith. He didn't look at a new TikTok challenge on faith. He knew that he had to study to show himself approved. So he flowed in his own generative homiletical methodology, much like Dr. Haynes, our homiletical savant. He understood the difference between egotistical preaching manipulation and childish caricature and life-affirming metamorphic proclamation during evocative preaching. He was an exemplary exegete because he understood he couldn't rely on his own personal knowledge, his own existential recollections, and fleeting pop culture titillations. He knew that he had to dig deep in order to bring the people what they needed. And so he knew he had to use seven hallmarks of wise preachers, what I see in Dr. Haynes. He was critically thinking about who Jesus was. He was using his mind to analyze who Jesus is. He was interpreting what Jesus does. He was explaining his response to Jesus' promises. He was self-regulating his response to Jesus' commandments. He was maintaining open-mindedness for all the followers of the words. And he was constantly problem-solving life's issues and circumstances through deep faith in Jesus. I believe that Paul wanted to share a word of hope to the people in Rome. So he looked for source material. He checked his library, hard copy and digital, you know, because a non-reading preacher is soon irrelevant. He looked for primary source material, not somebody that said somebody said that somebody said. He looked at dictated notes in his phone because a good preacher is always working on the next sermon. And good preachers are constant learners and listeners and observers and interrogators. And they look at life around them and they talk more about great ideas than trivializing people's relationships. And Paul recalled the words of the elders who had taught him, like Gamaliel and Priscilla and Haynes and Brown and Wright. And he began to reading something besides social media posts. And now he's not even researching and passing on tweets without attribution. Now he's not looking at the news talking heads, but he starts reviewing the footnotes and the commentaries of the seven books that are always open on his desk. He begins to read and reread his sermons that he preached years ago. He prays and he prays and he prays for God to tell him what the people need for such a time as this. And this is difficult work for pastors. The hard work of a pastor is to love the people enough to want them to live. The head work of a pastor is not transactional performance, but transformative proclamation. My mentor, Dr. Prathia Hall, once said, faith is not faith until it's tested in the crucible of the struggle and the fiery trials of life. Paul had experienced faith. He had lived faith, but he knew he had to have more information for this, so he goes to the Psalter, to the Song of Ascents by David, one of 15 psalms composed by the Hebrew pilgrims on their way to worship. In spring worship, it was an anniversary kind of ritual, and he goes right here to 124, and he listens to the plea because they had been in trouble, but only God could bring them out of trouble. And he looks at this psalm because it starts with a conditional, complete sentence. If a certain condition is true, then a particular thing results. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, then I will turn. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and then if you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. See, these are the kind of conditions that we know about. Something's true, something's going to happen. And in this psalm, the worship leader begins to talk about how we got over, how we lived through all this time. It says, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side. If it had not been, that means it's past tense. It had been, which meant God was on our side before. So you know that God has already done something. Because in the first place, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side when our enemies came around us, then they would have won. When they came into our parking lot uninvited, then they would have still been here. If it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, then the floods, all the mess would have swallowed us up. If it had not been for the Lord, we would have been ruined. If it had not been for the Lord, we would have been in the first building that we were ever at in 1983. Bless the Lord who didn't give us over to the prey, to be prey for their teeth. David said the enemy is like lions running around with sharp fangs, always wanting to tear us apart. And the truth of the matter is sometimes in church, the lions are going around trying to tear us apart. He said, but we escaped like a bird. God let us fly above the mess because God loved us. It reminds me of Langston Hughes' protege, Lucille Clifton, that says, "Won't you celebrate with me? What I've shaped into a kind of life. I had no model, born in Babylon, non-white, and a woman. I made it up here on the bridge between starshine and clay. My one hand holding light, my other hand. Come celebrate me that every day something has tried to kill me, but it failed. Every day something tried to kill me, but it failed. Every day of my life something tried to kill me, but it failed because God was on my side." The anyhowness of God, the dialectical form of reconstructing and reconstructing the if-then kind of faith. He begins writing a remix, a mashup message about the foundation of our first. He's writing to Roman, fleshing the words of David, who prophesied the people that were similar to what Paul was facing. Paul tells him, God's spirit will displace any power of sin. We are heirs to God's glory. We are already justified because God loves us. The whole creation is going to groan when God starts moving. God hears our cries, and God will move, not on our clock, but on God's clock. God has a plan for each of us, and God has never lied. God will never fail us. God says, if you believe on Sunday, you got to work it out on Monday through Saturday. God never leaves us alone. God is always carrying out God's plan. So when an enemy comes, they will sit down and shut up because God is in charge. He says, the Spirit is present in the midst of our deepest needs, that no plan is going to go. He says, now God is the God of already and the not yet. So he begins the sermon using David's context, and he says, what shall we say for all this stuff? We could have been dead sleeping in our grave, but God stepped in and protected us. Every time they tried to tear us apart, God was there. God was securing our salvation. So in a four-part hymn fragment, the preacher outlines God's presence in our difficulty. If God is for us, who in the world is big and bad enough to be against us? If God is for us, that presupposes that God is for us. If God is for us, if God created all things, if God promised to keep us, if God is for us, who can stop and block God's progress? Nobody, it says. If God didn't hesitate to put everything on the line for us, what more can God do for us? God gave us all so we would know that God was the one in charge. God loved us so much that God gave us the greatest gifts. Who can bring charges against us? They can talk. Because the people will talk, but they can't prove it. Who can curse us? Who can erase us? Who can judge us? Who can defeat us? Our very lives are in God's hands. God, they've tried and tried and tried. They tried us, but in the divine court, God is our defense attorney. Who is foolish enough to mess around with one of God's children? Who can touch one of God's anointed? They will come after us, but they will fall. They will come after us, but nothing's going to happen. They'll keep on talking, but God will keep raising us up, and every bit of dirt they throw on us, God just raises up a little bit higher. Jesus Christ died for our sins so we wouldn't have to be falling to our enemies. Who is going to condemn us? Who is going to disenfranchise us? Who is going to defer us? Who is going to dehumanize us? Who can objectify us? Who can thingify us? Who can point a finger? Because when they do, God will say, get away from us, Satan. God's grace is with us no matter who we are. No matter what we are doing, the claws that seek to kill us, God gets rid of. The tongues that lie about us, God gets rid of. The pen that they want to write us out of history with, God teaches us how to write our own history. In our internal and external forces, they diminish us, but God is there. Who can separate us from the love of God? Only we ourselves. Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Well, hard times or trouble or persecution or homelessness or nakedness or bullying or meddling. We are more than conquerors because God loves us. All we have to do is go through a kenosis experience and get all the junk out so God doesn't have to make a reservation to be inside us to protect us. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Paul says, I'm convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things in the future, nor powers can come, are able to shake what we have with God. I'm persuaded. Nobody can take that away from me. I'm absolutely convinced that I have an inseparable if-then relationship with God. If God is for me, who can be against this? If I believe that God's got this, why do I keep going around with my face hanging down? Why do I keep asking other people's opinion? Why do I always have a committee to see if God is for me? I know God is for me because God has been with me every step of my life. Won't you celebrate with me that every day I have lived, someone has sought to destroy me, and I am still here? In the text, Paul's sermon research is like Dr. Haynes' unique sermon structure. He always moves back to the beginning and says, you thought I forgot about that. He moves back and says that thing he says about you're going to miss your shout. So Paul goes to the ending of Psalm 124 and points to the reality that no one pastors unless the people are present, that readers need an audience, that the evidence of proclamation has changed the life of the listener, that perfunctory applause is vapid without a call to change. So he goes to the community now. Across 38 years, the community has listened to a pastor's voice. They can hear the pastor and the people. Can you hear the attestation of God's power and the confirmation of God's deliverance and the corroboration of God's presence and the documentation of God's promises and the evidence of God's intercession and the proof of God's care? Can you hear it over the years? Verse 8 says, our help is in the name of the Lord, not in the name of Pastor Haynes. Not in the name of Friendship West, but our help is not in the name of President Biden. Our help is not in the name of whoever is the governor of this state. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Can't you hear the people coming together with the preacher? Sometimes discordant, sometimes tone deaf, sometimes in perfect harmony, sometimes with tears stringing down and snot running everywhere. Can you see what happens when people join together with the pastor and proclaim the goodness of the Lord? That they can sing Swing Low Sweet Chariot and We'll Go Sweeping Through the City or Amazing Grace because they know that there's always hope if God is present. Because they know there's a faithful God they've been talked about who will make wrong things right and his lightness comes out of our darkness so they can sing We're Marching to Zion or How Great They Are or Rise Up and Walk. Won't you celebrate because they remember they were taught about an astounding God who gives strength to the faint and courage to the weak, who looks high, who sits high but looks low, who knows about He's Sweet I Know but can sing Precious Lord Take My Hand or How I Got Over or Marvelous, my favorite thing. They were taught that there's a remarkable God who stills our storms and wakes us up every morning and they can say, touch me, Lord Jesus, because you give me peace, be still, because on a happy day my awesome God will have no failure whatsoever, that there's an extraordinary God who keeps secrets and protects us in trouble, that God blocks whatever comes at us, and you can say, touch somebody's life because I thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. There's an astounding God who never lies or goes back on promises, who restores hope and salvation, and you can say, my soul is anchored in the Lord because through it all, I thank God because he decided to die, but the next 3 days, he got back up again. There's a faithful God whose source of our being, who knows every fiber of our body that down through the years has kept us so we wouldn't let go, who has we get a feeling that everything's going to be all right because God is always in his plan. There is a God that the mothers and fathers of faith believed in who will tell us that weeping may endure for a night, but joy is going to come in the morning because God is the lifter of our head and gives us blessings upon blessings upon blessings and put a praise on it, and we know everything's going to be all right. Won't you celebrate with me 38 years that every day somebody tried to kill his pastor, but he's still here. They tried to kill him with their tongue, but he's still here because God was with him. 38 years, this pastor has led Friendship West through zealous worship and Zoom conferencing, yearning for equity, yielding results, zenial hospitality, exuding confidence, whispered hope, welcoming strangers, volunteer ministry, voracious reading, unabashed celebration, unifying projects, thinking critically, teaching truth, speaking the unspeakable, suffering silently, renouncing oppression, realizing dreams, quickening spirits, questioning minds, provocative sermons, protesting supremacy, protecting defenses, outright initiatives, opining opportunities, nurturing relationships, novel ministries, mentoring youth, marrying the loved ones, loving the people, languaging hope, justice sensibilities, joy-filled worship, increasing faith, inclusive politics, housing the homeless, honoring the elders, gut-wrenching mourning, giving freely, forth-telling, feeding the hungry, educating children, eating healthy, deliberately meeting, dancing in joy, dedicating officers, community development, clothing and naked, burying the dead, burying it, breaking the silence, barrier-breaking, advocating justice, and ultimately giving all he had to Jesus. 38 years of if-then faith. Won't you celebrate with me 38 years of if-then faith? Won't you celebrate with me 38 years of if-then faith? Our poetic pulpit prophet, often imitated but never duplicated. God only made one Frederick Douglass Haynes III. Sometimes he takes to heart Audre Lorde, and when I speak, we are afraid, and our words will not be heard nor welcome. But when we are silent, we are still afraid, so it's better to speak, remembering we are never meant to survive. Sometimes he muses on the poetry of Octavia Butler. We were born not with purpose, but with potential. All that you touch, you change. All that you change, changes you. And one lasting truth is change. God is change. Sometimes he converses with a common. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposed in us. Justice for all, justice ain't enough. And sometimes he's validated by Kendrick Lamar. I got loyalty. I got royalty inside my DNA, don't you see? But I think at the end of the day, because he's lived a few days, because he's experienced God in some places nobody's ever been, at the end of the day, I think he goes back to Margaret Pleasant DeRoe, who said, if it had not been for the Lord on our side, where would I be? Where would I be? If it had not been for the Lord on our side, where would I be? Where he kept my enemies away. He let the sun shine through a cloudy day. He rocked me in the cradle of his love when he knew I had been battered by the storm. So if it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? Won't you celebrate with me? An if-then kind of faith. God bless you.
Woo-hoo. Wow. Wow. What a preacher. What a gift. Wow. Thank you so much, Dr. Teresa Fry Brown. Told y'all the queen of homiletics has blessed us this day. If then, don't you want that hookup, that connection? If then, if God is for us. I don't know about you. I can't make it without a sense that God is for me. And so, for those of you tuned in, and listen, you tuned in, and I don't know how, but I know God pushed you into this moment where you can make a decision to connect with this God who will give you that testimony through every test. If God is for us, who can be against us? If it had not been for the Lord on our side, will be your testimony. So here it is. If you'd like to connect with that God through our Lord and Liberator, Jesus the Christ, right now there's a number on the screen. Go ahead, dial it. Don't wait, hesitate, or vacillate. Dial that number. I have prayer warriors who are waiting to minister to you. They're going to minister to you, and this day you will experience that new life that will move through this life with the notion, with the idea, with the truth, the liberating truth. If then, if God is for us, who then can be against us? And then you're saying, hey, I got that part right, but listen, I'm feeling this kind of church. I want to join this church. I feel God leading me to join Friendship West. Listen, we'd love to have you. I'd love to serve as your pastor. Even virtually, we will be coming back. I promise you, we will be coming back, and we look forward to you joining with us. If you're in another state, country, listen, you can still connect with us. So go ahead right now, dial that number on the screen, and we look forward to the relationship that we will develop. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the power of your word. Thank you so much for using your preacher in such an amazing, convicting, uplifting, empowering fashion. Thank you for the power of your word. And now, God, I cover in prayer everyone tuned in, those who tuned in troubled, struggling, tuned in and wondering how they were going to make it, and you gave them a word. Now may that word liberate them, uplift them, encourage them. Then I pray
for those who need to connect with you. Oh God, push them even right now. Spirit, move with power so that they will go ahead, dial those numbers, and be connected with you. For those who you're leading to join this church, we look forward to the fellowship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and hallelujah. Would you celebrate with me one more time? Dr. Teresa Fry Brown, thank you so much, Dr. T. You are an amazing gift. Wow. That's all I can say is wow. I want to thank you. Wish I could cut loose with Frankie Beverly right now, but I want to thank you. Thank you so much for being you. It trips me out that I've been here 38 years, and my grandfather pastored Third Baptist in San Francisco for 38 years, and so to make it as long as my grandfather did is indeed something I am honored and excited about. I see family in the Friendship West Zoom room, so it's really good to see all of you. I have brothers from another mother. I have sisters from another mister. I'm really glad to see all of you. I won't call all names right now because literally there are too many, and it makes me just so excited. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you to my family who's in the house. I got fam in the house. I want to thank all of you for being here. Again, thank you so much to our staff that worked so hard to make this happen. Thank you very much. This has been uplifting second anniversary during the context of a pandemic. And last year, of course, we didn't really have it. But this year, we said, let's make it happen. And I really appreciate all of the hard work. And so thank you, Ebony Haynes, for your leadership and for the wonderful way that you always show love to your dad. You are a real gift, and I appreciate and thank God for you. Let me also thank my wife, Deb, for her constant care and determination that we live as she expresses her love. So thank you so much. Yesterday, Ricky Smiley texted me and said, man, I'm in town. Are y'all open? And so I said, man, just come on by. And so I thought it was a part of something, you know, and he didn't even know, and just happened to be here. And so, man, I'm really excited to see you and thank God for you. I thank God again for all of the staff. Staff, you are a gift to me, and I appreciate you not only for being a gift to me, but especially for being a gift to the body of Christ, for the loving, hard work that you do. The music ministry blessed me today. Saul, you don't even know this, but when I preached my first sermon at Third Baptist in San Francisco, July 22nd, 1979, the song right before I preached was the song by Walter Hawkins and family, God Will Open Doors for You. So that was like a flashback, and that has been like a theme song for my life and ministry since then. And so that was absolutely powerful. Praise dancers, my God. Awesomeness. Thank you very much. God used you in such a very powerful and beautiful way. Thank you to our AV, our communications, to everybody. Let me make sure I get these announcements because I don't want to mess this up. First of all, Friendship West and Hunger Busters, we're still serving, and so we're having a free food and water giveaway this Thursday. Free, F-R-E-E, free, this Thursday at 10 o'clock a.m. Right here at 2020 West Wheatland Road. So please arrive early. It's going to be at 10 o'clock a.m. 10 o'clock a.m. No pre-registration is needed. Just show up. Free, good food, fresh food. We don't play. So make sure that you are blessed and you're here this Thursday at 10 o'clock a.m. I want to thank all who continue to bless our efforts to be to make a difference in the lives of those impacted by the winter storm. As you know, Ricky Smiley gave us $10,000. Thank you, Ricky. But I also want to thank those who came through just this week. I think it was Tabernacle Baptist Church out of Augusta, Georgia, sent over $8,000. And so I want to thank you so much for your generosity. Don't forget, early voting is still going on. Let me tell you how important your vote is. Do you know if the voters in Minnesota had not elected the Attorney General for the state of Minnesota, the brilliant Keith Ellison, who took over the case against the racist, terrorist, evil Derek Chauvin and took it over, assembled a dream team, responded to the organizers and those who were protesting, and as a consequence, this week accountability took place. But it took place because there was voting that went on. Somebody voted. And listen, we could run that all the way through, but voting is vital. Please, Dallas, it's important to vote. Our municipal elections are going on right now, and if you're in Dallas County, you can vote right here at Friendship West. And so please, today is a day for you to vote, so make sure that you handle your business. The joint election is the election officially is this coming Saturday, May the 1st, so make sure that you vote. All right, I think oh yes, the Black Lives Matter sign. We got that back up, but listen, we got a new one, and it is absolutely amazing. Of course, we know Black Lives Matter, so does Black Black Money. And so that's why we did a Black Business to make sure that we got the sign up. Please make sure you see it. It is fire. And for all the haters who always want to email me, because it's like, how you gonna say Black Lives Matter when God loves everybody? Yeah, I know God loves everybody, but America don't love black people. And so we want to make sure that everybody knows that Black Lives Matter. Why? Because guess what? All lives ain't gonna matter until black lives matter. Black lives matter. That's the missing piece in all lives matter. So please let me, please get off me and don't say no more stuff about that. All right, God bless you. It's offering time. It is offering time. God has generously blessed you, and you have been amazing. Last year, I'm not going to lie, the first Sunday that we did our virtual service, I said, okay, God, I guess this is it. We're going to basically have to shut down. But Friendship West and all of you around the country have been so generous, and we have done more ministry during the pandemic than we did pre-pandemic. And y'all know we were doing the thing pre-pandemic, but because of your generosity, because God kept blessing you and you kept being a blessing, God has used you so that God could use us to continue to do what we do. Even right now, those who are houseless are being ministered to every single week because of your generosity. We gave over $100,000 in scholarships this year, and we're going to do it again in the coming year. And so God continues to give to you, and then you give to God, and then through us we bless the community. No wonder the Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. No wonder Jesus said it is more blessed to give than it is to receive. Even when you are giving, there is a blessing in the giving, and God is doing what only God can do. So won't you right now generously give to our great God? It's offering time. You see how you can give right there on the screen. You can text to give. Text your amount to that number. Text FWBC and the amount. Also Givelify. Download the Givelify app. Search out Friendship West. Give through that vehicle, of course, through friendshipwest.org. So please, won't you give generously and lovingly, and then watch God do what only God can do for you, as God does so much through us. Thank you. God bless you, and God keep you. Am I done? Okay, cool. So God bless you. Please have an amazing week, a powerful week. Don't forget to join us on Wednesday, noon and night, to study God's word. And we look forward to all that God will be doing. Thank you to everyone. I love you. Thank you for making this day so special. Dr. Teresa Fry Brown, OM to the Jeezy. You is a preacher. Thank you so much. Did you see the Floyd Thomas is on the Zoom room, and Michael Eric Dyson, all them on there. Yeah, Dyson is on there, my brother-in-law and sister-in-law, all them people up there, my cousins. I mean, all of y'all. Okay, who?
Taylor is up there. My cousin Taylor with Roxanne and Ron. Good to see y'all. All right, God bless you. Please receive the benediction. I love you so much. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause God's face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of God's countenance upon you and grant you peace. Go now in the power of God's Holy Spirit, fueled by an if-then faith. In Jesus' name, peace.
I want this time that I'm visiting to be the last time I'm a visitor. You can join us. Here's how you do that. Join us by calling the number 469-498-0210 or email us at joinus@friendshipwest.org. When you email, email your first name, your last name, and your cell number, and we will get back with you. We're so excited that you are here. Until next time, blessings on you.